Yes, kids! Hey, it is so good to be with you today. Hey, Max Thunder. That's right, adventure man, international explorer, wilderness pioneer, and lover of all things of the outdoors. You know, you probably already knew this about me because I'm so rugged, but I live off the land. That's right, that's why I had to sneak up on my tacos before I attack. Right there, Taco Bell, living off the land. Hey, it is so good to be with you today, because guess what? I almost didn't make it. Let me tell you what happened. All right, I was trying to chill after last week's crazy adventure. I was just laying down in my hammock. I looked up and I saw a rainbow. Hey, not just one rainbow, I saw two rainbows. That's right, double rainbow. And you know the legend, right? At the end of a rainbow, there's a pot of gold. And I'm thinking, two rainbows, that's two pots of gold. So I sprung out of my hammock, went on a search. I could see where it started, I could see where it ended. I had to wade through a swamp. I had to run across I-205, don't recommend that. I got lost in Clackamas Town Center, but I persevered and I found the end of the rainbow. Now, it wasn't a pot of gold, it was something much better. It was a tray, a gigantic tray of Chick-fil-A chicken nuggets. That's right, and at the end of the other rainbow, it was a bucket of waffle fries. I was in heaven. But here's the deal. You know the legend, right? At the end of the rainbow, there's a leprechaun defending those chicken nuggets. I had to take him out. And you know what? That's exactly what I did. I took him out. I took him out to lunch. And we had Chick-fil-A chicken nuggets and a whole bucket of waffle fries. Whew. It was a close one. Hey, but I lived to tell the tale. And I'm so glad I did, because we've got something so special planned for you today. All right, we've got the great teaching, we've got a craft, we've got a game, and of course the memory verse, and we're gonna kick it all off with some worship.
This is how I know what love is. This is how I know I'm free. This is how I know salvation. Jesus came and he died for me. This is why I come to worship. This is why I lift my hands. This is why I now surrender everything I am. Because of your love, there's dancing in my heart. Because of your grace, I am free. Because of your why there's joy within me. This is why my spirit sings. Jesus, you're my great adventure. You're my everything. Because of your love, there's dancing in my heart. Because of your grace, I am free. Because of your of you.
so great to be with you again. I'm Teacher Kathleen, and I love exploring God's Word with you guys. And today, I'm going to start off by talking about plans. We all have plans, right? Plans to hang out with friends, plans to go to the pumpkin patch, plans to take vacation. But you know, this year, so many of our plans have changed, right? Things have gotten canceled, things have gotten rescheduled. But let me tell you something about God's plans. God's plans are solid. They can never be thwarted. All right, thwarted, that's kind of a weird word, right? But you hear it a lot in this context. It just means that God's plans can never be stopped. They can never be prevented from happening. And we're going to see that today in the story of Moses. But first, let's look back at last week. Teacher Chandra taught about Joseph. She explored just his amazing life journey. And actually, the book of Genesis ends with Joseph in Egypt with his father's family. And he's with his father's family when he actually dies, when he's 110 years old. That's pretty old. Now, the book of Exodus, it begins telling us that the Israelites, they have multiplied, meaning that their population has really grown. Okay. At this news, Pharaoh is pretty concerned, all right? Pharaoh is thinking, gosh, the Israelites, they've become so numerous that they're a threat to Egypt because there's so many of them. So what Pharaoh does is he decides to put slave masters over the Israelites, and that they force them to work incredibly hard, all right? Then Pharaoh goes to the extreme where he orders that all of the Israelite baby boys be thrown into the Nile River and drowned. Like, this is an incredibly tragic period in Israel's history, all right? But God has not forgotten his people. He still has a plan for Israel, and he has a plan for Moses, all right? So we pick up in chapter 2 with the verse of, talking about the birth of Moses. Okay, so we're in Exodus 2. And at this point in the story, Moses' mom, she's desperate to keep Moses alive, all right? So this is what it says. She says, she hid him for 3 months, but when she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and coated it with pitch. Then she placed the child in it and put it among the reeds along the bank of the Nile. Okay, so picture this. She hid Moses for as long as she could for 3 months, but then it came to the point where she had to do something. So she gets a basket. Maybe it looks something like this. She put baby Moses in a basket, and she had to float this basket in the Nile River. And she basically was just putting baby Moses in the hands of God, all right? So as we read further, we find out that it's Pharaoh's daughter that actually finds Moses. And she picks him up and she ends up raising him. She adopts him and raises him in the palace, only after they allow Moses' mother to care for him as a small baby. All right. Now, only God could have orchestrated this, right? If you think about it, you know, Pharaoh was trying to control the Israelites. He was trying to kill off all the baby boys in Israel. But God has a plan for Israel. God has a plan for Moses. God's plans cannot be stopped. Okay, at this point, you would think, okay, Moses is in the palace. You would think growing up the palace would be amazing, all right? But Moses, he's actually conflicted. Even though he's being raised as an Egyptian, he just finds it difficult to see the Israelites, his people, being mistreated. So one day, when he sees an Egyptian mistreating and beating an Israelite slave, he becomes enraged. He's so angry. He lashes out. He actually kills the Egyptian and he hides his body, which is terrible, right? Then the next day, he sees two Israelites fighting and he asks them, you know, why are they treating each other this way? This is how one of the men responds to him. He says, "Who made you ruler and judge over us? Are you thinking of killing me as you killed the Egyptian?" Then Moses was afraid and thought, "What I did must have become known." When Pharaoh heard of this, he tried to kill Moses, but Moses fled from Pharaoh and went to live in Midian. Okay, Moses is on the run. He does not feel like he belongs in Egypt. He feels like his own people, the Israelites, they don't identify with him. Then he feels like Pharaoh hates him at this point, right? Because Pharaoh's trying to kill him. So he runs. He goes to Midian. He starts over. He wants to start a whole new life. And it's there in Midian that he actually marries a woman named Zipporah, which is just a cool name. And they have a son, And he ends up leading this sort of simple life. He takes care of his father-in-law's sheep, and he cares for his family. All right. Now, meanwhile, the Israelites, they are still crying out to God. They are in trouble, right? They're still slaves in Egypt. All right. So this is how chapter 2 actually ends. It says, the Israelites groaned in their slavery and cried out to God. God heard their groaning and remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. So God looked at the Israelites and was concerned about them. Okay, do you think that God wants us to cry out to him when we're in trouble, when we're in a difficult situation? I mean, the answer is yes. He always wants us to come to him. I mean, think about David in the Psalms. He's constantly crying out to God, right? He's crying out for relief, for guidance, for forgiveness, for protection, right? God wants us to come to him. And then, do you think that God cares when we cry out to him? Does he care about what we're going through? And the answer is yes, God cares. He sees us, he knows what we're facing, and he's concerned. And that's exactly what that verse just said. God is concerned about the Israelites, all right? So chapter 3 starts with God putting his plan in motion. And he starts off by getting Moses' attention. All right, so imagine Moses. He's out there, he's in Midian, he's taking care of his sheep. He's probably thinking he's having somewhat of a normal day. All right, but he sees something in the distance. He looks and he sees something burning. And he gets closer and he realizes it's a bush. All right, this is how it's described in chapter 3. This is verse 2. There, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in the flames of a fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight. Why the bush does not burn up? When the Lord saw that Moses had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. Okay, this is crazy, right? I mean, imagine Moses. He sees this bush and he thinks, well, this is strange. It's burning, but it's not being consumed. It's not being burned up. Then he hears his name, Moses, Moses. So what does he do? He says, here I am. All right, and this is what the Lord says to him next. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. Oh, I'm sorry, I skipped ahead. Verse 5. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals. This is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. Okay, imagine. All right, Moses is having this amazing moment, right, where he realizes he's in the presence of God, all right? He takes off his shoes, all right? Picture that. Takes off his shoes, puts them to the side. He hides his face, all right, because he's afraid to look at God. He's in awe of God's holiness. Have you ever had one of those times in your life where you've just been in awe of God, where you feel like God's presence is so evident and you feel like he's speaking to your heart? I've had those moments many times. And one of those times was when I saw the Grand Canyon for the first time. This is before I had kids. Mike and I were married just a few years, and he was actually in seminary when I was teaching school. And we had a lot of time off in the summertime. So we took a big road trip. And one of the places we stopped was the Grand Canyon, and we camped there. We had a great campsite pretty close to the rim. And so we decided one morning we were going to wake up and see the Grand Canyon as the sun was rising. All right. And so we're in our tent in the morning. It's hard to get up early. And we're thinking, is this worth it? Should we do it? Well, we get out of bed. We get close to the rim. And you all, it was breathtaking. I don't know if you've ever been to the Grand Canyon, but it is massive. And to see the sun rise, to see the colors sort of bounce off the stone and the rock, it really did take your breath away. And we felt like it was one of those moments where we were just witnessing God's majesty, his beauty, his power. It's like we were having this intimate moment with our Creator. And it was a holy moment. And you know, at this time in the story in Exodus, Moses is having a holy moment. Okay, now God has specific things to say to him, all right? This is verse 7. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians, to bring them out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey. Okay, this is the promised land, right? The land that God had promised back to Abraham. All right, then God says in verse 10, "So now go, I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt." All right, there it is, God's plan. He wants to send Moses to Pharaoh so that his people can be freed from Egypt. All right, how does Moses respond? Is he like, "Yes, this is the chance I've been waiting for. Let's go." Okay, not quite, right? Moses, he's afraid. This is what he says. He says, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" All right, he's thinking, the Israelites, they don't even like me. And the Egyptians, well, Pharaoh wants to kill me. So he is intimidated. He's afraid to go back. And have you ever been in a situation where you've been afraid to step into a place or a situation that God has called you to go? I know I have. I was thinking about a time when I was younger, when I was in ninth grade, and my youth group was actually taking a ski trip to Colorado. That's what a lot of Texas youth groups do. They load up buses, they drive to Colorado, you ski for a few days, they have speakers at night, and then you come home. So I felt like this particular year, God was nudging me. He was leading me to invite a friend of mine from school to go on this ski trip. All right. This friend was not a believer, did not know the Lord. And I was nervous. I was really afraid to ask her. I didn't know what she would think. I didn't know if she'd want to come. And if she did come, would she like it? I just was nervous. I just didn't feel good about it. And I felt like God was telling me as I was praying about it that he was with me, that I was not in this alone, that I didn't have to be nervous, that God was with me. And it gave me the courage. And I stepped out, I asked her to come on this trip, which seems silly now because why wouldn't anyone want to go skiing? but she came and it was a really cool thing and she got to hear the gospel. And I'm so glad that I invited her. So it was really crucial, that point where God just spoke to my heart and reminded me that he was with me. And that's what he does with Moses, all right? He says, "I will be with you." All right, Moses needed to hear that he was not alone. And then later, when Moses is expressing concern about his ability to speak, all right, he just didn't feel like he was a good speaker, God reminded him, he is the one that gives man his mouth and the ability to speak, that he will be able to give Moses the words as he needs them. I think about that part of the story a lot when I'm teaching, when I'm speaking. I get nervous when I speak, but I know that God's with me and that he'll give me the words to say when I depend on him, which is a really cool thing. All right, you guys, we're at the end of the story. What does Moses ask? At the very end, he asks a really significant question, all right? He says, "Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' What shall I tell them?" He's basically saying, "God, what should I call you when I talk to the Israelites?" And this is how God responds. God said to Moses, this is verse 14, "I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am sent me to you." Okay, that's a really strange title when you first hear it, right? I am. It's kind of confusing, mysterious. I remember when I was younger, I thought it wasn't complete. All right, but it is complete. This is the name by which God wants to be known by the Israelites. This is the name he wants to be worshiped by. So it's really a significant name. And to me, it's an overarching title, all right? And it causes us to ponder just the magnitude of who God is and all that he encompasses. In Hebrew, the word is Yahweh, the Lord. And it makes us think of the eternal God who is holy and faithful and true, all right? So guys, this story of Moses, it's huge. It's so rich with so many truths. And we're going to continue it next week. Teacher Chandra will talk about when Moses actually goes into Egypt to confront Pharaoh. But I want to leave you guys today with three takeaways, three things I want you to remember from the story. All right, one, God's plans are solid. They're certain. They cannot be thwarted. There's that word again, thwarted. They can't be stopped or prevented from happening. Okay, do we believe this? I mean, this truth should give us courage and strength. All right, takeaway number two. All right, God often calls his people into situations that stretch us and that cause us to depend on him. So are we listening to God's voice? Are we listening to those nudgings? And are we looking to him for guidance? All right, and takeaway number three is God is the great I am, right? He is the Lord. He is Yahweh. He is the God that is eternal, that he is holy, He's faithful. He is true. This is a God we can trust in. All right. I love this story. Let me close us out in prayer. Father God, I thank you so much for the story of Moses. It does remind us, Lord, that you do have specific plans for our world and for us, and that your plans can never be stopped. You are in control. And Lord, also, I thank you for Moses. He just sets a good example of someone who steps into a difficult situation, a situation that could be scary, but he knows, Lord, that you are with him. And remind us, Lord, that you are always with us. You see us and you know what we're facing. And finally, Lord, I just want to praise you. You are the great I Am. You are Yahweh. You are the eternal Lord, Lord of heaven and earth. And we just praise you today. And it's in your name that I pray. Amen.
Strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Wherever you go.
Let's do that again. Have I not?
Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Wherever you go. Wherever you go.
Wherever you go?
Wherever you go.
Wherever I go?
Wherever you go.
Wherever you go.
Wherever you go. Wherever you go.
That's it. Joshua 1:9.
Hi friends, Teacher Nicole here. I'm back to show you your crafts for today. We talked a lot about Moses. First when he was a baby, so that's our first craft. Moses as a baby. You remember what happened? He got put in a basket, and he got put in the river, the Nile River, and his sister followed him and watched over him. That kind of reminds me of God. God watches over us. Oh, thanks, Miriam. Okay, so after you color your sheet, cut along the top dotted line and cut around Moses in his basket. Then you're gonna cut along the dotted line here. You're gonna make a slit. And you're just gonna put little Moses in his basket right up here. And he's gonna go from his sister, down the river. Oh man, but don't worry, it's okay. He doesn't die because, as you know, our next craft, oh, it's Moses. And he's at a burning bush. But the bush didn't burn up. Why was that? Oh, right, because God was there. He was standing on holy ground. So our craft for today, once you color it, do you see up at the top? There's like a second set of feet. That's weird. So cut those feet out once you've colored them and cut along the dotted line. So it's gonna look like this. Oh, look at that, all colored. Then you're gonna take the extra set of feet and down here where there's this little picture that looks like a glue bottle, you are going to glue the next pair of feet, right like that. Because God says, take off your sandals, because where you're standing is holy ground. Oh man. So we can take Moses' feet and fold them over, and then he took his shoes off. Oh, and now he put his shoes back on. And now he took them off. And now he put them back on. There you go, our craft for the day. Ah, I hope you had a great week, and I hope you're having a wonderful weekend. And I love you, and I can't wait to see you again soon.
Hey guys, Teacher Kathleen again. I have got an activity for you today, and it has to do with the part in the story where Moses, he goes to Midian, right? He's running away from his life in Egypt, and he's hiding from Pharaoh. But this whole time, even though the Egyptians, the Israelites, they don't know where Moses is, God knows where he is, right? There's never a time where Moses is out of God's sight. He's always with him. All right, so our game today is flashlight, hide, and seek. All right, let me tell you how it works. Basically, one person gets a flashlight, like this, okay? Gets a flashlight, and They leave the room. The other people in the room, they are gonna hide and turn off the light. So they're hiding in the dark. All right, the person with the flashlight comes in and can seek with the flashlight. So it's basically hide and seek with the twist that it's in the dark and the person has a flashlight. But the people hiding will realize that the person with the light can always find them because they have the light. All right, so play some flashlight hide and seek. You could even do it outside at night after dinner. That could be kind of fun too. So enjoy, have fun, and see you guys later. Hey, River West families. It is great to see you. As you may have heard, we as a church are involved in the wildfire relief effort, and we are trying to provide items to families that just have specific needs during this time. And so we're asking you to bring in some of these items on Wednesdays from 9 to 3:30, and you can just drop them off right inside the church entrance. There'll be a place for you to put them. So let me give you an idea of some of the items that we're collecting. You could bring in Band-Aids. You could bring in hairbrushes, all right? These are some of the things they're asking for. Also, games for kids like Uno, Connect Four, school supplies, pens, pencils, paper, and also they're asking for masks. So if you have any of these extra items in your house, if you could bring them by on Wednesday, that would be great. It's just a real practical way to love people in our community that have some needs right now. So hope you have a great week, and we will see you later.
Here we go. Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain from beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, oh hallelujah, hallelujah, your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, oh hallelujah, your love makes me sing.
Your love is surprising, I can feel.
And now I put his shoes back on. And now I took them off. And now I put them back on. And now I took them off. And now I put them back on. And now I took them off. And now I put them back on. And now I took them off.